The disciple's journey towards the guru is very strange. The disciple is blind. He is ignorant and cannot see the path. He cannot move ahead on his own. It is the guru who leads him on. Thus, the guru is not only the goal of the disciple, he is also the guide, the one to whom we are attached with the rope of faith on our mountain climb. Trust, thus, is the first prerequisite. If you cannot trust the guru, you cannot be led. Hence, even though the guru is fountainhead of spirituality, it has been advocated that the would-be disciple check out the guru before wholeheartedly accepting him. The Buddha advised as much. Just as gold is examined through burning, cutting, and rubbing, so you should thoroughly test my teachings and accept them, but never out of reverence for me. Swami Vivekananda had such an attitude at first towards Sri Ramakrishna Paramhansa. Once, the young disciple wanted to test his master's statement that he was unaffected by money. So, he put a coin below Ramakrishna's pillow. The guru could not sleep that night. Vivekananda's test had merely proven the spiritual armor of his guru. Rid of doubt, the disciple can then humbly approach the guru. His relationship with his spiritual guide rests on a firm footing. He can entrust himself to his guru in life as in death. Only after the strong foundation of trust or Shraddha has been laid is the spiritual superstructure built. Man has to realize anew that he is a spiritual being made in his image. The guru prods the disciple to reach his divinity. A small story narrates how a cub had been separated from his tribe of lions. He began to live with the sheep. In the time, his behavior became exactly like theirs. He no longer roared. He bleated. A tiger saw him one day and was overcome by surprise. He caught hold of the still young cub and gave him a hard shake. "What is the matter with you?" the tiger roared. "Why do you behave like a sheep?" The terrified cub insisted that the tiger was mistaken. He was just a sheep. The tiger took the cub to a lake. The clear water reflected the cub's face. Immediately, he realized his true nature. The guru's none too easy task is somewhat similar. He demolishes the apparatus on which our mistaken identity rests. We are his children, not creatures of mortal flesh and feverish blood. We are divine personages, clothed in hide, not desire-led animals. We are soul encased in bodies, not bodies with soul. Such a turnaround occurs only when the disciple truly touches the Guru's feet, that is, when his ego flakes away from his self. Only then does he receive the spiritual charge that wakes him up. The Guru is a spiritual powerhouse, transmitting the current of spirituality into his disciples. At his graceful touch, the disciple awakens. Much preparatory work has to be done. However, we are laden with the psychological ferment and karmic baggage of lifetimes. The powerful eddies generated by our karmas acting on minds not equipped with the right attitudes can break our legs even as the journey begins. So, the Guru puts us in situations where we learn life lessons. Armed with the axe of right attitude, we hew our path through the many obstacles of life. The Guru's grace is never more evident when lives come up with a challenge or a test. At such times, to quicken the spiritual evolution of his child, the Guru can take the disciple's karma upon himself, elevating its misery-causing effects. Sensing that we are about to set our foot on a karmic crevasse, he lifts us up and carries us on his own shoulders. What encomiums can be heaped on such a guru? He can only be silently loved, fully followed. Yet, there are times when the disciple resents his guru. The guru leaves no psychological stone unturned to perfect his spiritual son, but the disciple's commitment wilts as the guru operates on his mental makeup. Howsoever much the disciple may flinch from his guru's ego-hurting blows, the guru, bent on the disciple's perfection, carries his task through. At such a weak moment, the disciple can't summon the will required to thwart his habit, but he only realizes that the guru is taking pains on his behalf. The Guru's sole interest, unlike the self-interest concealed in every human relationship, is the disciple. His only interest is to take the disciple's Godward. Whether he moves his mountains of karmas out of the disciple's way to do this, whether he heals himself of disease or of mental plagues, that is his wish. These are only means to end of leading the disciple to God. The Guru selflessly spends a huge amount of energy and time in fashioning a disciple. The journey up the spiritual mountain is no picnic. Spirituality, as the Sadguru transmitted, is not a comfort-giving philosophy. It is no cosmetic cream that can make a social faces or psychological mask look more beautiful for the moment. It is not a set of rituals and rites that we can fulfill to gratify ourselves or to flatter God. The spiritual terrain is a life-consuming affair. It is not a path that one's tread can be walked out of. Once you are with a guru, once you accept his stewardship, you must go wherever he leads you. The guru is our only chance to reclaim our divinity. He is the ladder that leads to God. He is the one who grants us self-realization. Everything in his hands is a device. From how he escapes the crowd, to how he positions his relationship with us. But at all times, he is our guru. No matter whether he is joking or lending an ear to happenings of the day, he is our guru, first, foremost, and last. And only through pleasing him, or through attempting to please him, shall the disciple succeed in getting to his cherished goal. Remember also that the guru is not to be literally emulated. There is a story of Adi Shankara and a disciple who used to imitate each and every action of the great master. On a pilgrimage, the master stopped to take some alcohol from the hands of a peasant. The disciple, close on his heels, did so likewise, and probably with a great enthusiasm. Some distance ahead, the great Vedantist stopped again. Molten iron was coming out of an iron foundry. Unconcernedly, Sri Shankara asked for the liquid, cupped his hands, and took a sip. The disciple was disarmed. He could not follow his master now. The Guru's words have to be followed in letter and spirit, no doubt. Yet, the disciple should not imagine himself to be the guru under any condition. It is much better to be continually engaged in loving, remembering the guru. That way, the guru and the disciple are always linked in spirit. Spirituality in the hands of the guru is a weapon to disarm our ego, unless we are ready to be thus mercilessly exposed. Do not seek a guru or say you follow him. If you come to a guru, rest assured that you will not receive continual ego messages. In fact, once you have fallen for a guru, even slight indications of his favor may disappear. The greatness of the guru lies in that he takes us as we are, warts and all. He loves us in spite of our blemishes. He sets no preconditions for our entering his path. Entirely self-sufficient, absorbed in cosmic bliss. He wants nothing, craves nothing. In his vision, all are alike. He sees no distinction. he favors none. Like the sky, he encompasses all without touching them. He is the eternal witness. His unblinking eye, steadfast on eternity, is intimate with each and every flowing thought in the stream of his disciple's mind. The Guru is the highest. He is incomparable. His grandeur is above even that of the lords of heaven. The sun, the moon, the stars are but incrustations of finite cosmic dust on his robe. The Holy Trinity, the countless gods and goddesses, the yogic powers are at his feet, ready to do his bidding. The Guru is God. The Guru is Shiva himself. In the Shiv Purana, Lord Shiva denies Lord Brahma's plea to create beings bound by mortality. He instead vows to descend on earth to remove such beings from incessant round of births and deaths. He came as Guruji. In the dust of his feet, what a bliss. May Guruji have mercy on you and I. May the rain of his mercy fall on our foolish heads. May we, through the very charge of his being, be laid at his feet.